I'm Dr. Ailey Kalapilla from Emory University. In this national HIV curriculum mini-lecture, I will provide a summary of the antiretroviral medication dolutegravir, abacavir, lamivudine. Dolutegravir, abacavir, lamivudine is a fixed-dose combination single-tablet regimen made up of the three medications shown on this slide. From here onward, I will refer to this combination medication as dolutegravir ABC3TC. The tablet is to be taken orally once a day, either with or without food. Dolutegravir ABC3TC is a single tablet that is a complete regimen for the treatment of HIV type 1 infection in adults and pediatric patients weighing at least 25 kilos. They should have no known prior resistance to dolutegravir, and they should not have the HLA-B57 allele. As I just mentioned, prior to using dolutegravir ABC3TC, HLA-B57 testing must be performed to avoid risk of abacavir-associated hypersensitivity syndrome. This I will discuss in more detail later on in this talk. It is also recommended that hepatitis B serological testing be performed prior to initiation. The reason for this is that current HIV guidelines recommend that individuals with HIV and hepatitis B co-infection take an antiretroviral regimen that contains two fully active antiviral agents against the hepatitis B virus. In dolutegravir ABC3TC, only the 3TC or the lamivudine component has hepatitis B activity. In fact, long-term use of lamivudine monotherapy for hepatitis B is not recommended due to the risk of developing antiviral resistance. To be clear, this does not preclude the use of dolutegravir ABC3TC in persons with HIV hepatitis B co-infection, but it does indicate that the antiretroviral regimen will eventually need to be intensified with the addition of an additional antiviral drug to adequately treat the hepatitis B. Patients who are prescribed dolutegravir ABC3TC need to have their renal and liver functions checked prior to initiating the tablet. The single tablet regimen is not recommended for use in individuals with a creatinine clearance below 30 mL per minute or in individuals with mild hepatic impairment, so child PU class A or higher chronic liver disease. Next, I am going to delve into more detail on the mechanism of action of the key drugs that make up dolutegravir ABC3TC. First, let's talk about lamivudine or 3TC and abacavir or ABC. These belong to a class of drugs called nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitors, abbreviated as NRTIs. They work by blocking HIV reverse transcription. They resemble the human nucleotides in structure, but when incorporated into the elongating chain of DNA, no further nucleotides can be added, hence they act as chain terminators. Now, moving on to the drug dolutegravir. In order to understand the mechanism of action of dolutegravir, we first need to review the HIV integrase enzyme. HIV needs to integrate the linear double-stranded HIV DNA that is formed by reverse transcription into the host genome. The integration of HIV DNA into host DNA is performed by the HIV integrase enzyme using two key steps. First, the processing of HIV DNA, and then second, the strand transfer of HIV DNA to host DNA. Dolutegravir belongs to a class of drugs known as integrase strand transfer inhibitors. As the name of the drug class suggests, dolutegravir works by binding to the integrase enzyme and blocking transfer of viral DNA to host DNA. Now, let's discuss notable clinical trials studying dolutegravir ABC3TC use as a combination antiretroviral regimen. So in the next several slides, I will talk about two broad groups of clinical trials, those that were done in treatment-naive adults and then trials done in treatment-experienced adults. In antiretroviral treatment-naive individuals, the single study was a randomized, double-blind, non-inferiority study that evaluated the safety and efficacy of dolutegravir administered with fixed-dose combination abacavir and lamivudine versus a fixed-dose combination regimen of efavirenz-tenofovir emtricitabine. The dolutegravir administered with the abacavir lamivudine fixed-dose tablet that is used in this study contains the same doses of drugs as in the dolutegravir abacavir lamivudine single-tablet regimen that is the main focus of this talk. You can see the inclusion criteria on this slide. As you can see, 833 participants were enrolled and randomized to either the dolutegravir or the efavirenz arm. The primary objective was to demonstrate non-inferiority of dolutegravir-containing regimen compared to the efavirenz-anchored regimen with viral suppression, so an HIV viral load less than 50 copies per mil, at 48 weeks on treatment. At week 48, the proportion of participants with an HIV RNA level of less than 50 copies per mil was significantly higher at 88% in the dolutegravir group than 81% noted in the efavirenz-containing group, thus meeting the criteria for superiority. Also, the proportion of participants who discontinued therapy due to adverse events was lower in the dolutegravir group than in the efavirenz arm of the study. Participants receiving dolutegravir and abacavir lamivudine had small mean increases in the serum creatinine level compared to the efavirenz arm. This finding is consistent with previous studies of dolutegravir, and it is thought to be due to the dolutegravir-induced inhibition of tubular secretion of creatinine, which does not impact actual GFR. Now, let's move on to the GS380-1489 study. This was a phase 3 randomized double-blind active-controlled non-inferiority clinical trial comparing safety and efficacy of the fixed-dose combination bictegravir-tenofovir-allophenamide-emtricitabine, or BICTAF-FTC, to the fixed-dose combination dolutegravir-ABC-3TC. You can see the inclusion criteria on this slide. 631 participants were enrolled and randomized to either the dolutegravir or the bictegravir arms of the study. The primary objective was to demonstrate non-inferiority of the bictegravir-containing regimen compared to the dolutegravir-anchored regimen with viral suppression, so an HIV viral load less than 50 copies per ml, at 48 weeks of treatment. This table shows baseline characteristics of the study participants, which, as you can see, were comparable between the two arms of the study. At 48 weeks, co-formulated BICTAF-FTC achieved virological suppression in 92% of previously untreated adults and was non-inferior to co-formulated dolutegravir ABC-3TC. Additionally, there was no evidence of treatment-emergent antiviral resistance in either study arm. This table shows the adverse effects, which were mostly comparable between the bictegravir versus dolutegravir arms, except that BICTAF-FTC had better gastrointestinal tolerability than the dolutegravir regimen arm. The study investigators also looked at measures of renal function. Results here show that at 48 weeks, percentage changes in quantitative and tubular proteinuria were similar between the two groups. Changes in hip and lumbar spine bone mineral density did not differ significantly between patients in the bictegravir versus dolutegravir arms. Also, the changes from baseline in fasting lipid measures were generally similar between groups at week 48. Finally, let's discuss the STRIVING study. This was a randomized, open-label, phase 3 clinical trial done in adults who were already virologically suppressed on an antiretroviral regimen. You can see the inclusion criteria here. 533 subjects were randomly assigned to either immediately switch to dolutegravir ABC-3TC single-tablet regimen once daily for 48 weeks. This was known as the early switch group. Or they could continue their current antiretrovirals for 24 weeks and then switch to dolutegravir ABC-3TC, known as the late switch group. The primary endpoint was the proportion of subjects with a viral load less than 50 copies per mil at week 24. At week 24, 85% of subjects who switched to dolutegravir ABC-3TC had viral suppression compared to 88% who remained on their current antiretrovirals, indicating that dolutegravir ABC-3TC was non-inferior. At week 48, 83% and 92% were virologically suppressed in the early and late switch groups, respectively. So, in review, the two studies I had discussed done in treatment-naive individuals were the single study and the GS380-1489 study. The single study compared dolutegravir plus abacavir lamivudine to efavirenz tenofovir emtricitabine. The results indicate that dolutegravir plus ABC3TC had a better safety profile and higher rates of virological suppression through 48 weeks than efavirenz tenofovir emtricitabine. The GS380-1489 study compared two fixed-dose combination regimens, specifically bictegravir, tenofovir, allophenamide, emtricitabine versus dolutegravir, abacavir, lamivudine. Bictaf-FTC had better tolerability, comparable safety profile, and was non-inferior to dolutegravir ABC3TC in achieving virological suppression at 48 weeks. I also discussed the STRIVING study, which was a switch study performed in treatment-experienced individuals who had virological suppression. And the conclusion drawn from the STRIVING study is that in virologically suppressed treatment-experienced adults with HIV who switched to a single tablet regimen of dolutegravir ABC3TC, the regimen was safe, effective, and non-inferior compared to continuing their current antiretroviral regimen. Now, let's review some adverse effects associated with dolutegravir ABC3TC use. Perhaps the most serious adverse effect is a hypersensitivity reaction associated with the abacavir component of the single tablet regimen. This reaction is quite severe, often involving multiple organs, and can be fatal. It usually occurs within 6 weeks of initiating abacavir, and patients who carry the HLA-B57 allele are at a higher risk of this hypersensitivity reaction to abacavir, underscoring the importance of knowing the patient's HLA-B57 status prior to giving them any abacavir-containing regimen. Also, it is important to note that the hypersensitivity reactions can be seen in patients who do not carry the HLA-B57 allele, although this is a rare event. Other less common toxicities include hepatotoxicity, which can occur due to flares of hepatitis B in co-infected individuals, given that the dolutegravir ABC3TC tablet contains only one active antiviral agent, the 3TC, to treat hepatitis B, and hence the barrier to developing hepatitis B drug resistance is low. Hepatotoxicity, which includes elevated serum liver enzymes, hepatitis, and acute liver failure, have also been reported in patients, including pediatric patients, receiving dolutegravir-containing regimens who had no pre-existing liver disease or other identifiable risk factors. Lactic acidosis and severe hepatomegaly and steatosis, particularly in female sex and obese patients, have been reported with NRTIs, which include lamivudine and abacavir. However, it is important to note that these two are quite rare. Other commonly reported but less severe side effects associated with dolutegravir ABC3TC are also listed on this slide. So, in summary, dolutegravir ABC3TC is a once-daily complete antiretroviral regimen that has been co-formulated into a single tablet. It is a complete regimen for treatment-naive individuals or treatment-experienced individuals who have a suppressed HIV viral load and no resistance to dolutegravir, abacavir, or lamivudine. The medication has a high genetic barrier to developing drug resistance, so it could be a potent and practical HIV treatment option for individuals who are eligible to receive the drug and for whom there is concern for poor adherence. It is a large pill that patients may find difficult to swallow. The tablets may be crushed and added to a small amount of semi-solid food or liquid and consumed immediately. The medication should not be prescribed to individuals with the HLA-B57 allele because of the risk of abacavir-associated hypersensitivity reaction. When given to individuals with HIV and hepatitis B co-infection, an additional hepatitis B active antiviral drug must be added to ensure adequate treatment of the hepatitis B. In general, the medication is well tolerated without many drug interactions. Finally, in summary, dolutegravir ABC3TC is a potent option for initial therapy with a high genetic barrier to resistance or as a switch regimen, but the need for HLA-B57 testing prior to use of the drug is one of the main reasons why the drug may not lend itself well to either rapid or same-day antiretroviral treatment initiation.
The production of this National HIV Curriculum Mini-Lecture was supported by funding from the Health Resources and Services Administration.